vital.
All right, we got about 2 more minutes. We'll give just 2 more minutes to get everyone in and then we'll get started.
So how many people, Brooke, are there so far?
30, 40, well, it keeps going. 43, it keeps going. So we're at 43 right now.
Okay,
And
fantastic.
46, yeah. So typically, I heard we had about 50 in person. So I think sometimes Zoom gives a lot of people the opportunity that they wouldn't normally have. So I'm glad that we can, still do this. So.
Absolutely.
All right, well, it's 12, so I'm gonna be mindful of everyone's time. I'm just gonna take my mask off so I can say hello to everyone. Thank you so much for coming today to our very first speaker series of the 2021-2022 school year. We're super excited to get this kicked off again. My name is Brooke Anderson. I'm new to Westlake, not new to Eanes. I was at Valley View for 4 years and have now transferred over to the high school as one of the student support counselors. So it's very nice to see everyone. I see some familiar faces already in the participant list, so it's really great to see everyone. I'm also super excited to get to introduce you today to Anjali Maazel. She is going to be our first speaker series. She's going to be talking about aligning with purpose for standout college applications, how to really ace that college application, college admission letter. So excited to hear from her and hear her tips that she has. Just so everyone knows, we do have the chat room open, so feel free to write a question in that comes to your mind during the presentation if you don't want to forget it. We are going to hold off, though, on answering questions until the end of the presentation, but there will also be a time for personal Q&A, so where you can ask a question directly to Anjali. So thank you all for coming, and now I'd like to turn it over to Anjali.
Thank you, Brooke. Thank you so much. And thank you for this opportunity to connect with the Westlake community. I've done so in the past and really have enjoyed interacting with parents and students. Brooke, I just wanted to be sure, is there a firm cutoff at 1 p.m. or can we go over? What is it? What is the best way?
This is Colleen at the library. You're okay to go a little longer with us, so it's fine with me.
Okay, so how much longer? Because I sometimes questions kind of extend, and I just want to be mindful, of what is right
You know what? I'll double check on that, but why don't we say 15 minutes for now? I'll just
for
make
asking.
sure that we don't have to have somebody else using the Zoom, but let me double check, okay?
Thank you, and thank you so much to West Bank for this platform. Thanks. Thanks
Sure.
again. So welcome everybody. If you are thinking about college planning for your kids, you really have come to the right place. My name is Anjali Maazel. I'm a former Princeton University interviewer, TED Talk speaker, and college admissions expert. I'm also the very proud mom of a thriving 23-year-old now in grad school. At Anja Education Consultants, which I founded, we've helped hundreds of students to get into their top perfect match schools, including Yale and Stanford, Johns Hopkins and Vanderbilt, Swarthmore and UT Austin, including also hidden gems of colleges and wonderful places for these kids to thrive. So as a Princeton interviewer, I learned how to have applicants stand out, what colleges are actually looking for. And as a parent, I learned how important it is to teach our kids that college is just one step in creating a life of purpose, not an end in itself, not a destination. So, what kinds of questions are uppermost in your mind? Whether you put them in the chat and then Brooke will look at them or ask me at the very end. This is important. And there's no Q&A, but there is a chat. So make sure that you tell me which grades your kids are in. Now, I will also be sharing a Google form for you to fill out. So you don't have to take notes today. I will be sending you the slides and the handouts. So please feel free to just relax. And I am putting the Google form link in the chat right now. And I'll do it a little bit later as well. So just feel free to fill that out after the meeting and you will get access to all the information. Very good. So how do we reconcile? Because a big question and the core of this talk today is reconciling student achievement with well-being, right? Acing college admissions while protecting student well-being. So the answer to this question is quite simple, based on my experience and the research that I have done. It's based on the science of purpose, how purpose can serve many functions in our lives to protect our mental health, and a process I've developed called Talent Development 3D. So we're going to be looking at that in greater depth. Now, these keys, the research on purpose, which has been done by many universities over the last 10, 15 years or so, is about how there has been a noticed increase in well-being, but also protection for things like physical illnesses, chronic illnesses, also mental illnesses, protection by developing a sense of purpose, what really matters to us, what really drives us and lights us up. And these are the kinds of alignments that are so helpful to guide our students along. And there's a way of doing this. So, and then how do you find out more about this science of purpose? I will be giving you handouts, not only on the research, but also on Challenge Success, which is one of the initiatives that Westlake High School is very aligned with. And I'm very happy about that because these are powerful tools for you as parents, and also Turning the Tide. So Challenge Success was developed by Stanford University, Turning the Tide by Harvard. And these are approaches to reframe college admissions to protect student well-being. So one of the keys here is reclaiming time for reflection, helping the kids to really start to align with what matters to them. And when I work with kids, I have a self-reflection component of the work that helps them to begin to identify how they might want to use their talents to benefit themselves through establishing a career that will give them financial independence and financial stability, and also to benefit the world. So the path of talent is this talent development 3D that I have developed, and it is a proven blueprint really for not only protecting well-being but also acing college admissions. I will give you that blueprint later on in the presentation. So again, the handouts, slides, and a gift for you for participating in this webinar, for being a Westlake parent that's participating in this webinar. I have put that Google sign up. I will also put this other discount and link for you in the chat, because my gift is going to be something that I think you will appreciate. So I'm putting that in the chat as well, and I will do that again later. Now, and of course, you don't have to take notes because I will be sending you the slides and the handouts. Okay, so the blueprint, you know, starts with the idea that you want your kids to be, let's visualize, it's October 15th of your child's senior year in high school. And What are you and your team thinking about at that point? October 15th, senior year. Because your kids have submitted their 8 to 15 high quality applications early, they have their first acceptances rolling in. They've also gotten the scholarships you were hoping for. And they have gotten, and so as a result of all of that, you now have the funds, the time, the peace of mind to plan your winter break vacation that you've been fantasizing about for years. What you're thinking about is kind of mountain or beach, domestic or international, or, you know, maybe a staycation. But in any case, that's what you're thinking about. And in this scenario, what is your child thinking about? So instead of being close to burnout by juggling applications with schoolwork and extracurriculars and other responsibilities, and instead of dreading their winter break because they're going to be cramming their applications and submitting subpar essays, your teen is now free to pursue the academic and extracurricular activities that mean the most to them. Additionally, as first semester senior year grades are often looked at by admission, your kids are going to have the energy to perform well in school instead of getting exhausted trying to juggle the applications at the same time. So, tip number one, earlier is definitely better. So for tip number one for outstanding applications, focus on your timeline when applications open. Focus the timeline around when they open rather than when they close. So when they open is generally August, when they close is generally December through January. And the reason is rolling admissions is more and more a fact, and that's kind of first come, first serve. Whether a college admits it or not, or calls their process rolling admissions, especially as a result of COVID, more and more colleges are trying to fill their freshman class early. They also allocate resources on a first-come, first-served basis. By resources, I mean scholarships. Take UT, for example. That's a prime example of this. So the question becomes then, how do you get ready to submit standout applications as early as possible? Now, when I say as early as possible, the caveat is we have to place that within the context of the student's development. A student who has spent all summer in a very high-powered internship where they just didn't have the time, you know, between junior and senior year, they may start their applications later, and that's okay. So even if your child is in 12th grade, I want you to know that there are always ways to streamline this process and to reduce stress. I'm just talking about really for parents of 11th graders and younger. So how do you get ready? How do you get these kids ready to submit those standout applications? So toward the end of this webinar, again, I will share that blueprint. But first, I'm going to introduce you to the steps of the blueprint through three case studies with one tip for each case study. So let's start with Tony. Tony came to me. This is a student I worked with, starting in 10th grade. And he said, oh, I'm really good in math. My parents and the school system and, you know, adults have always been telling me you'd make a great engineer. But when he said it to me, he kind of slumped in his chair and looked down and sighed. I could tell his heart really wasn't in it. And then he added, and I also make art. He was almost apologizing, but when I looked at the artwork that he had done, I saw that he had quite a lot of talent. So I connected him with a local art mentor, helped him organize to go to the Rhode Island School of Design for the summer between junior and senior year. And after he came back from that summer, he said to me, I know what I want to do. I want to go into architecture. And the interesting thing about that is that it combined his love of art with his strength in math. So now he's a very happy, thriving student at Rice University in architecture. He turned down a $100,000 scholarship from Tulane, but Rice was his first choice. So his GPA was quite high. He had both the academic and the artistic components, and we were brought together. His story is really about how to find the major and the career that a student wants to do. And by making the right choices for extracurricular activities and summer plans, he found out what he wanted to major in. Then we could find his perfect match colleges to apply to. Now, the benefit of this is that the guidance in career and major planning saved his parents time and money in college through him having greater clarity. Because imagine if it had played out, he might have ended up in engineering. Even if he had finished, he might end up 10, 15 years later going, you know, this, I knew this wasn't for me, but hey, you know, by default. So we don't want that for our kids. We want the optimal path, if possible, for many, many reasons. So the tip number two, which is associated to his story, is instead of asking your teen what they want to be when they grow up, notice what lights them up, number one, and what problems in the world or issues that they see or needs. Or even for artists, it can be things like seeing a way your art can benefit the world. See how their talents could help address some of these needs and issues. And help them find that sweet spot through between passion and aptitude, between what they love and what they're good at. Also, the choice of extracurriculars and summer programs, for next summer, if you're a junior parent, it's really important. And that's one of the places where expert guidance can make all the difference. I do use not only interviewing the student, but also top of the line interest and strength assessment to have them compare where they're at in their interests and their aptitudes with people in different careers to see where that perfect overlap might be. Okay, so now let's go on to Ellen. And Ellen was in a slightly different situation. I worked with her last year, and she's now a business student at Emory University. Now, she needed to maximize her scholarships while maximize her scholarships while coming into the process with a high B average. So whereas Tony had, a high A average, she came in a little bit lower. Now, we focused on telling her story around two aspects, because this story of Ellen is really about how to tell a compelling narrative, which is the heart of Standout essays, but also Standout applications. So we focused on telling her story around two aspects. First of all, how she improved her GPA over the 3 years, 9th through 11th grades, and through hard work, and how she took initiatives outside to get mentorship in fields that were challenging for her or that she was interested in. Also through taking very rigorous classes. So that was one part. The second part was her extracurricular experience in yearbook, which helped her develop some managerial skills. And she combined that with an internship at a startup incubator. Now, she showed in her essays and the way she talked about her experience in her interviews, etc., how all of these threads came together. So I was able to help her weave her talents and her experience together, and this got her admission into her top school, which was Emory, as well as 12 scholarship offers ranging from $20,000 to $100,000. So the tip here is for you all is to see your child or help and also help them see their 3-year journey as a story. How do their academic and extracurricular interests fit together? How can the threads be combined to reveal who they are? The first step is helping them through that interest and strengths assessment that I mentioned. That's extremely helpful. And the second is brainstorming session. That's what I do with my students. You can also do it with your kids. It is all about story that ties in with their authentic selves. Now, authentic selves, you know, you might see that as on all the admissions websites and think, oh my gosh, this is such a buzzword. It's so annoying. But actually, it holds the key to this process of combining achievement with well-being. And that's to help through all of these steps, all of these little decisions you're going to be helping your kids take over the next years, helping them align with what really matters to them, with who they really are. As I said, when I work with students, I have a self-reflection component of this. And, you know, you can also encourage them to have that experience of self-reflection to understand how they might be able to use their talents to benefit both themselves and their community and the world. Okay, so next I want to talk to you about Maria and her daughter Grace, who I worked with Grace last year, and they experienced the peace of mind that Ellen and Ellen's parents experienced, because the benefit there that Ellen experienced and her parents was optimized admissions results, financial savings through scholarships, and peace of mind. So Grace and Maria, her mom, were also able to experience that. And I want them to share their story with you directly. I'm gonna play a very short video. Now keep in mind that this one, and I will give you the tip that comes from this after the little explanation that they give, is about testing. ACT versus SAT, test optional, you know, whether to submit scores or not. And Grace, she mentions a $20,000 scholarship in the video. That was per year. So actually it was an $80,000 scholarship from her first choice school. She was also awarded a $199,000 scholarship from her second choice school. So here is Grace, and here are Grace and Maria.
Hi everyone, I'm Grace Sorensen, and I'm a long-term client of Ms. Anjali. We began working my freshman year. Right away, she got to know my family, my passions, and what I saw myself doing beyond just the years of college.
I have to agree. I'm Maria, and I'm Grace's mom. And I would have to say the best thing about Anjali and working with her is that she's super organized. She uses a lot of technological tools that keep us organized with calendars and scheduling. What I loved is that she made Grace responsible for all of it. So selfishly, I didn't have to do all of that. And I actually love that she made her become very independent and very responsible for her learning and for her goals and reaching them. We love her dearly, and Absolutely. We are very grateful for her because she goes far beyond just academic learning and growth.
And I'm so proud to say and so thankful to be able to say that in these 4 years, thanks to her help with my applications, I was able to get a $20,000 scholarship to my top pick school, which is California Institute of the Arts, also known as CalArts. So thank you, Ms. Anjali, for everything that you've done for me. We love you so much, and we can't wait to see what other lives you get to change. Thank you.
So what Grace in this little presentation didn't tell you is that actually we gave her a ACT versus SAT diagnostic at the very, very beginning to see which test she would score higher on. Now her results from that came back, you know, showing that she would have to work extremely hard to raise her scores. And she was very involved in the kinds of extracurricular and academic activities that many of your kids are involved in. And so when we weighed everything and looked at what the best strategy would be, we decided to take advantage of the test optional policies that have come about through COVID, mostly through COVID, and have her not submit her test scores. Now, the tip here is really to be strategic about the test optional opportunities. So what you want to do is use the 50th percentile of the previous couple of years admitted classes, which are often put that 50th percentile of scores for each college is usually on the website. It's easily findable. To use that. And so if a student scores toward the high end, the top of that 50th percentile or above, generally it makes sense to submit the test scores. If they are at the bottom of that 50th percentile or below, generally speaking, it's not a good idea to submit the test scores. Now, what you also want to take into consideration that is not all test optional schools are alike. Those that have begun to be test optional during COVID, they are not as well versed in how to assess a student just based on other criteria. There are some colleges that are historically test optional, places like Smith College or test flexible like New York University. And there are even colleges that recently have become test blind like the University of California system. That means that your student will be able to submit, will not have to submit any scores, because even if they sent the scores in, they would not be looked at. The test flexible for NYU means that they can submit, for example, AP scores instead of the SAT or ACT. So there are many, many opportunities. It's important to really be strategic. One thing I want to say, make no mistake, the SAT and the ACT are not, they are not aptitude tests. They are called aptitude tests. They're supposed to measure, you're supposed to be able to take them without test prep. But the reality is what they're actually testing is how much prep the student has done. Now, of course, there's some exceptions. There are kids who just go in the first time and, you know, it just, they're good test takers. It comes easily to them. But, the trend now is going to be more and more toward test colleges that are going to be even test blind, because colleges realize that these tests do not predict college readiness or success in college. There have been many studies on this. So what can you take from that? Basically, we're in the system until all colleges go test blind. Students can have an advantage if their scores are at the top or higher than the 50th percentile of admitted students for each college. That's the reality. So test prep can be important. Now, you might be wondering how all of the pieces of the application process fit together, and where your student should start. You know, can you help your students start to align with purpose to ace college admissions while cultivating well-being? So over the years, I've developed a proven blueprint for what to do and when, which I want to share with you. And I want to show you how you can access it. Now, what I'm going to do is after this proven blueprint, I will be sharing final practical tips, the do's and don'ts of acing college admissions while protecting your child's well-being. So please stick around till the end of the webinar. So let's look at this blueprint. So now parts of this are how I work with students, but you can adapt that. You know, whether you guys end up working with me or not, you can still adapt that. And it is a blueprint that you can make your own. So I connect with students quite often. This part is about accountability. So, organization and accountability are your friends, spreadsheets and all of that, whatever your child needs to remain accountable. And these meetings can help. The other part here is the cutting edge strengths and interest assessment, which is extremely important. Now, I've put the blueprint beginning in 11th grade. Generally, when I work with 11th grade students, this is how we start, right? And we help them understand what kind of majors and careers they might want to explore. Then look at their transcripts. We look at their any gaps they might have to see if they need tutoring. We look at the choice of classes. So these are elements that will be looked at by college admissions and which you can have an eye on, right? Which courses are going to help them find that balance, including number of APs, right? Find that balance between well-being and achievement. Colleges do look at rigor of the curriculum. However, we want our children to be happy and healthy. So it's a balance. And then this talent development 3D protocol that I use boils down to three steps: discovering, developing, and demonstrating the student's talent through things like pairing them with mentors, summer planning, extracurricular and internship planning. And that's not only for the summer, but through the year. This keeps them aligned with their purpose while positioning them to have a great resume for college admissions. So the other part is that they will, many colleges are now asking for resumes, interviews. They are going to be communicating with the college admissions staff. So, and they will might be even communicating through social media. So when I work with students, I help them, basically prepare to ace all of these components. If you know that this is going to be part of the process, then you can take also the steps accordingly. And then after that, once I know what their preferences are, once I see their how their results, academic results, scores compare to the admissions trend data, then I help them develop a best fit college list. That college list should be balanced. Generally, I give students 20 colleges that I have whittled down from all the ones that are out there for them to research, and then students apply to between 8 and 15 colleges, generally speaking. And the important thing is it has to be balanced between likely, target, reach, and sometimes far reach schools. And we want to look at admission rates. Colleges can admit, this I know from my experience as a Princeton University interviewer, can admit between, 10 and 15 equally qualified freshman classes, the most selective colleges in the country. So we have to manage expectations and understand the system in order to make this as stress-free and exciting a journey as possible. And then I give students a SAT versus ACT diagnostic test to see which one of the two they would likely score better on, and we make a testing plan. And that sometimes can be with tutoring or not, but that is part, a very important part of the process. When we get to college applications, generally, in terms of timeline, I begin with, with 11th grade students in the spring with essays. And this, all aspects of the applications should be looked at and optimized. And, again, whether you're working with me or not, this is something to keep in mind. And then the essay component, that's when I start, as I say, in the spring with essays. We want to look at all the essays that are going to be done, including the honors essays, and any kind of essays for summer programs, competitions, and internships for the summer. Now, this kind of thing, it's important to make sure that each part of the application is giving something new. So you don't want the essays to repeat themselves, right? They can repeat a topic as long as the content is different, a different aspect of the same topic. And then once all of that is done and the applications have been submitted and the results start coming in, if there are any things like any aspects that need to be handled later, like helping students get off the wait list or negotiating scholarships, just know, again, whether you're working with me or not, there are strategies that you can, that are useful, that you can do to help students in both of these areas. And then finally, the most important thing is this focus on purpose. throughout, you know, so that self-reflection component, so that the student is really, this is becomes an adventure of self-discovery, not some kind of exhausting ordeal, right? We try to keep them really motivated about what lies ahead. And also growth mindset is something that, I use a lot with my students that you can look into and use also for student well-being. And that's seeing setbacks as an opportunity to learn rather than a statement about who they are and what their capacities are. So my gift to you now for this particular blueprint is a discount. If you do decide to sign up, and of course you don't have to, but if you do decide to sign up, then you will have a discount on these packages that I offer. So I will put that again in the chat for you, because I know a lot of people have come in since the beginning. So here is the link to sign up for those, for that. I also, the other gift is I'm giving you a 30-minute one-on-one session with me to explore how I might be able to help, you know, your questions and your concerns about the college admissions process. And by signing up for that one-on-one session, you will get the discount. So now let's look at what happens in before 11th grade. So for those of you who have students in 9th, 10th, or even in middle school, how can you help them ace college admissions, set themselves up for success, and protect their well-being at the same time? So that's the talent development package that's included in what we saw before for the 11th and 12th graders, but this is for the younger kids. So again, we do an initial strengths and interest assessment. It's a different one. It's not the same one that I give in 11th grade because, and you know, these are available out there, by the way. So when I say blueprint, I really mean blueprint. You know, yes, I'm telling you what how I work with students, but these are steps that if you decide to do it on your own, that's great, you can do that. And then looking at, you know, really understanding the student and looking at their talents. And then setting, you know, planning through helping them discover, develop, and eventually demonstrate those talents through things like that I mentioned before, all of the extracurricular and summer and regular school year opportunities. And then helping them consistently document and helping parents to, so do stay, make sure that your kids are gathering all that information. There are many platforms to help them do that. You can do it in a Google Doc where they, you know, all their accomplishments and little videos and things like that, or you can use a platform, things like Circled In, for self-reflection and resume building. Again, those two things can go together. Well-being and resume building do not have to be contradictory. They can go hand in hand and can be really a win-win strategy. And then we wanna be sure that whenever they apply, you know, that we proof their applications for the summer, for, you know, if they're doing an internship, whatever it is, that we help them succeed. And the other thing is we wanna look at their transcript. We wanna look at their classes. Is there something they're struggling with? Help them along the way. Also, make a personalized timeline. That's what I do for my students. A high school timeline. It's very helpful. Make it visual, make it fun. And for them, for all of you to know, you know, where you are now, where they need to get to, and what are the steps in between. And then the testing plans, for some kids, it's very early, you know, it doesn't have to be in the 11th grade. I work with, you know, kids beginning in middle school or, you know, 9th, 10th grades. It's very helpful to do this. Obviously, you're not gonna give them an SAT or ACT diagnostic in 7th grade unless, you know, they're at that point. But these are good to know. And, you know, just to help them stay accountable, that's what these meetings are about throughout the process. And we focus on growth mindset and purpose throughout. So my gift to you here is, again, if you sign up for a 30-minute one-on-one free strategy session with me, I will give you a $200 discount on these packages. And I think I will paste that in again in the chat, because I see as I'm speaking, I see more and more people actually joining. So I want everybody to have this. I want everybody to have this opportunity. Just give me one second, because I'm having a little, here we go, technological moment. All right. Okay, very good. So now what I would like to do is give you the final tips before we do this. I've already given to you, so the final tips before we go to Q&A. So what you want to do and not do are, start out with one thing. I think you know who this is. Don't put it off, right? Think about it today. See what steps you can help your child take to position them to be in a good place. Also, because if you are strategic, it will help with their well-being. Also, don't buy into myths. So look at these three statements. My children need to get into a top 10 to 100 ranked school to be successful in life. If they don't get into X school, their lives will be ruined. If they don't become a doctor, lawyer, engineer, they will be poor. So the reason these are false is not that it's my opinion. It's research has shown. Now, research from a variety of universities, some of which I will give you in the handout, so be sure to sign up for that. That the best predictors of success after college are not school rank, but being closely mentored by professors in college and engaging with the college community in an active way, which fosters a sense of belonging. A sense of belonging has been correlated to increases in GPA and well-being. And then from the World Economic Forum and the McKinsey reports, it's very important to choose work that's in line with the 21st century job skills, the soft skills that robots are, chances are with machine learning and all that, are not going to be replacing humans. So that is something also extremely important to keep in mind. So what else? What else can you do? So focus on fit over rank. That will help you redefine success in the college admissions program process, because what we want is we want thriving students. We want students who are happy and healthy and financially stable and doing something that they love and are good at. The other thing is college is one step in designing a life of purpose. Teach them growth mindset, look it up. It's super important. There are all sorts of language that you can use to help them in this process. Timeline is key. Look at when applications open. Of course, if you're in 12th grade parent, don't worry, okay? There's a lot you can do to help minimize stress even in 12th grade. But for those who are a little bit earlier in the process, there are opportunities. Support kids in being okay with not knowing what they want, right? Or what their passions are, or all of that, but help them start to take steps to find out, even if they're in 12th grade, you know? Because even that summer after they graduate, they can do all sorts of interesting things that will help them to clarify. Celebrate the Renaissance kids, okay? They are kids who have many talents, because believe me, the right fit, the best fit colleges will also celebrate them. There is a way to combine all these interests and to help them find a career that will really suit them. And make sure, as we said, that application strategy in the end is about who they really are, and tie in the narratives. These are the tips that I gave you earlier. Also do this. So make sure that colleges that your kids are applying to understand that the kids are extremely interested in that school, because the colleges are trying to manage their yield numbers, that is the percentage of students admitted who actually enroll. The more they feel a student is passionate about their school, the more they are going to feel that they can safely admit them without the risk of losing them to another college. Now, of course, it has to be done wisely. I mean, I guide my students very carefully, but through this process, you don't want to pester a college. But there is a way to really show them through also the clicking through their emails, because they are tracking students just like businesses track consumers. So other than that, clean up the digital footprint. There have been stories of rescinded admission results with students who had questionable things on their social media. But it's also not only doing that, but also they can connect through to professors through social media. And I do help them. I even help them create a LinkedIn profile because a lot of high school students are on LinkedIn. And then document early. We already talked about that through all sorts of different ways, creative ways to keep track of those accomplishments, and have students focus on the extracurriculars in a deeper, not a wider way. They should strive for mastery and really focus on process and growth mindset in their setbacks when they're learning this, not on their results. If they focus on the joy of mastery, which is actually something a term that has been coined in psychology, the process can be both enriching and foster their well-being while preparing them for standout applications. And then the last thing is rely on informed guidance as early as possible. This can make a very big difference for you. It's not for everyone, but it can be very, very helpful. So, without further ado, I am going to start answering your questions. Now, from West Bank, how much can we go over?
You know what I asked, and we're fine. We don't have a time limit. We have to shut off.
Okay, very good, very good. Brooke, could I ask you to do me a great favor so that I can focus on answering the questions? Would you be able to copy and then paste the link for those signups that I gave?
Absolutely.
Both of the links, the Google form and then the one-on-one strategy session links again.
Absolutely.
Because I see more people have come in and they may not scroll up to the top of the chat.
Absolutely, I'll do that right now.
Thank you so much, Brooke. Okay, so questions. Are we going to start with people unmuting themselves, Brooke, or are you going to be reading the questions in the chat?
Why don't we let those unmute and ask the question, and then we'll read the ones in the chat.
Okay.
Anjali, do you want to stop your share screen so we could see everybody? There we go.
Absolutely.
So if anyone has a question, now would be a great time to ask Anjali, and I'm going to bump some of those things up in the chat so that you do have the form to sign up.
I'm also, sorry, I am just going to briefly share my screen again, and while people are looking at those links and pasting, you know, copying the links. Because I wanted to end with this and be sure before people leave that, you know, we really say again what the focus is here, right? We want to help students discover their talents and build a joyful, successful life of purpose. We want them to thrive, right? I know we all do. And we want this process, the college planning and application process, to be both smart and strategic and deeply fulfilling for students and parents. You know, why do we have to suffer through this as well, right? So thank you so much for allowing me to share this very information that's very close to my heart. And yes, here's my contact info if you want to get in touch with me. So I will also put my email in the chat just in case. Right now, and then I will answer questions. Okay.
One of the questions in the chat, Anjali, was about they were speaking regarding their ninth grader and whether or not it's super important to have all AP or honors classes, and if that's too overwhelming, like, is it better to have classes that they feel they can really manage in terms of admissions to college?
Okay, that's a really good question. I actually just had a conversation with a student who one of the essays that he wrote, he's in 12th grade now, and one of the college essays he wrote was about how he misunderstood the transition from middle school to high school, and how he wished he had started with fewer APs in 9th grade. So this is a very personal question though, right? Because you as a parent, I don't know, what was the name of the parent? Oh, you're muted, Brooke.
Thank you. The name of the parent was, hold on. Let's see, Thesley Startsell.
Thesley, okay. So Thesley, you know your child better than anyone, right? You have to gauge and help them gauge how they can be sure to be getting enough sleep and, you know, doing activities and connecting socially in a way that's fulfilling to them while, of course, if they're ambitious, pursuing the kind of academic rigor that will help with their college admissions. My ultimate, feeling about the college admissions process, having gone through it with my own son, as well as hundreds of students, is that, if a college is not going, there are so many great colleges out there, right? If a college is not going to admit a student because they haven't taken, 25 APs by the time they graduate, maybe that's not the best fit college for that student. Maybe that's not where that student is going to do well and be happy. So just putting it out there. And of course, I'm not against, if a student can balance everything and take APs in 9th grade, sure, why not? Okay.
All right, another question is about the 6% rule at UT. Sharon asks, what do you see as the key measures for admittance to UT, seen as the 6% rule excludes many Westlake students? Do you have any particular thoughts or experience with the Moody College of Communications?
Okay, so really what UT is looking for, it's called fit to major. That means that they are looking at the grades, the extracurriculars, the resume of a student who they feel will align with the requirements of that major. So that is kind of the strategy that you have to think about, right? Does your student, who's not top 6%, have that alignment? And that is true of all the majors, whether it's Moody College of Communication or not. Now, there are some statistics for each department. Some departments at UT, are much more selective than other departments. So some majors are much more selective than others. It can vary year to year. You can contact UT admissions. They're very, very helpful. And, you can even ask for statistics from, the last couple of years for these different majors. Sometimes they have it, and if they do, they're usually quite willing to provide it, and sometimes they don't. Some of these things are published, some of them aren't. But definitely, do look, if you're looking at UT Austin, fit to major is the way to go.
Okay. Right. Okay, the next question is, they want to know if you review the essays with the students directly or through other professionals.
Okay, so before I created Anja Education Consultants, I was an English teacher and specifically a writing teacher. So I love working with kids on essays. I do not send those out to anybody else. That's just, I want to see the progression. It's very exciting to see students progress from the brainstorming all the way to the final draft, because it also, I love to help students learn about themselves. And again, if you're not working with me, you can encourage the student to use those essays as an opportunity to understand themselves, where they want to go, in where they want to be headed in life in terms of their goals, and rather than, you know, this is just, I have to crunch these out and get them over with. Okay.
Awesome. Okay. And then the other question is, how do we figure out between the hidden gems, colleges or universities?
Yes. So it's really good to know that they're hidden gems, first of all, right? They're really, really good. Now, one thing is during COVID, and I do want to make sure parents really understand this, is there's been some reshuffling of these schools because some of the universities with the big endowments have gotten richer, have gotten even more applications. And some of the schools that have smaller endowments where they have been harder hit, some of those colleges are struggling. So hidden gems, let's put with a caveat. Let's be sure, and parents can do due diligence. I do that, you know, with the students and families I work with. But if you're doing it, you can look at their financial health, their state of, you know, and usually a lot of this information is available publicly, because what you don't want is to send your kid to a school that is fantastic, but, you know, in 2 years, it may fold, or it may combine with another school that you may not like. Now, having said that, there are some amazing hidden gem schools with strong financials that I do advise students to look into. One great place to look at this is Colleges That Change Lives, CTCL, Colleges That Change Lives. I'm gonna put CTCL in the chat. Okay. What else?
Okay, the other question is, a parent wants to know, about how many students do you have on a yearly basis?
Okay, so I cap my students to, you know, 20 to 25 juniors. Then I go to wait list. I usually fill up really fast. I still have some slots open, but it's filling up. And then for the other grades, I'm very mindful to keep it within an amount that is really going to be sure that I'm going to be able to give my best. It's very important to me. My practice is all about personalization, and really it's a boutique practice. There are a lot of other practices out there that are, you know, have larger, more students, more counselors, and more kind of thing, but that's not my thing.
Great. And the other question that's up here is, how does it impact my daughter if she, currently a junior, is taking a couple of AP classes, pretty studious and diligent, but also has decided to take a free period during last period of the day to balance studies with overall well-being, such as daily exercise, nutrition, sleep, part-time work? Does that free period count against her, considered less rigorous?
Yes, this is a question I get a lot from parents and students, right? And you really, again, you know your child better than anyone. That you have to see how she's doing, right? How is she doing? Is that free period going to allow her to do some homework so that then she doesn't have to stay up incredibly late and be, you know, a basket case? Again, I bring you back to the idea that it's fit over rank, right? There are many fantastic colleges out there that are great fits for students and where students are going to thrive. For example, there are many schools that have a great percentage of their kids who get PhDs. These may not be the top ranked schools, but graduate programs really look at them very favorably. So, you know, yes, you want to have rigor, but again, it's all about your child's long-term success. So, you know, It's a balance and it's personal.
Great, thank you. Another question is, can you talk more about identifying, I'm sorry, it just moved up. Can you talk more about identifying your fallback, target, and reach schools, and how many colleges should you apply in each college bucket?
Yes, good question. So be very clear on one thing. Fallback and safety are terms that I don't use. I use likely, because I want every single school on that list to be a school that the student would love to go to. I never want to hear, oh yeah, this one is on the list because if all else fails, I'll have to go here. No, you know, there are enough great options in this country and even locally that we do not have to do that, right? So normally I have students put in three likelies and three targets, and beyond that, you know, they can do they can do reaches, far reaches, they can do more likelies and targets, it's whatever they want, but that it has to be a solid base. And the reason is that unlike, you know, 20, 30 years ago, schools are now managing their yield. Therefore, if they feel an applicant is overqualified or has treated them like a safe, quote unquote, safety school, which again, there are no safety schools except community college, but anyway, treating them like a safety school, they may not admit a student. It's called Tufts syndrome. It's actually something that happens. So we want to protect the student and have that solid base. How do we determine that list? Well, and which go into where? I use all sorts of data, right? I use admit rates and other data, but I also use my experience with those schools. So I know, you know, a certain profile will have a higher likelihood of admission. If you had to take out all the other factors, I would focus on admit rate.
Great. One other question is test optional available for 2023 graduating classes?
For 2023,
so next year.
Okay, so these are 2023, are a current
current juniors,
right? Mm-hmm. So, right, well, we're not 100% sure about that, right? Their policies have been changing, and they seem to change year to year, depending also on COVID and on how that evolves. You know, again, that's what, when I mentioned historically test optional schools, those are like Smith and or test flexible schools like NYU, New York University. That's not going to go away. You know, that's not going to go away. But the ones that have just kind of jumped on the bandwagon because they had to, you know, that's not clear. That's why I recommend that my juniors do test prep, right? And however, you know, if they turn out not to be, you know, good test takers, even with the prep, there are, as I say, historically test optional colleges.
Great. Next question is, where are you located? Do you think working with a local consultant who knows WLS well, I'm not sure, Westlake schools, I'm guessing that's what they mean, is more important, or working with a remote consultant who may have more knowledges about the colleges?
That rhymes. Okay, that's a good question. I'm in Austin, and I have worked with a lot of Westlake families. So just so you know, now I have been using remote kind of meetings, even before COVID. But you know, that's really a personal choice. I do have kids applying to Texas schools every year. So if that's a concern, you know, then the important thing is to make sure that the consultant is vetted by a professional association like IECA or another one like that. That is kind of protects you in a way. Any other questions?
Yes, there's one more. It's, are essays required for SATs and ACTs?
Essays required for, yes. Yeah. So more and more schools are not looking at that. So there is an SAT, ACT, essay component. I do not have my kids do it because it's just, you know, it's getting phased out, and I don't think it's worth the extra effort. That's just my, great.
I went ahead and reposted both the Google form to fill out information for Anjali so she can get in touch with you if you have any questions. And I also put in the other link that she admitted. I mean, that she put in the chat. I saw the admit button, so that's why I said admitted. Does anyone else have any other questions? We want to make sure we're getting everyone's questions answered today. So Before we sign off, are there any other questions?
I do want to specify those two links. The first one is for signing up for get the slides of today.
Thank you.
And the slides and the handouts. And the second one, it also has a link for the one-on-one meeting, but if you want the one-on-one meeting as well as the slides and the handouts, then definitely use the second link, because that one also includes the discount. So the link, and I'll post it again at the bottom. You just did, but I will I will just post it again so everybody is really, really clear on that. Oh, no, that didn't work. All right, maybe I can ask you to do it while I answer.
Sure, I'll do it.
Yeah, I see it. Yeah, if you don't mind, just the bottom one, the one that's ACING College Admissions Through Purpose. Yeah, yes. That's the one for the, yeah. Okay. Thank you. Mm-hmm. And so I see, oh, yes, I see a couple more questions. Do you want to read them off or
sure.
Shall I?
Okay. Oh, yeah, okay, so the one question is, how important are college visits?
Mm-hmm. So college visits, you know, they can be extremely helpful for a student. It is very good for them to get an intuitive sense of, is this a place where I would feel comfortable going to school? Campuses are so different one from the other. There are many different versions of a college campus. And so that can be extremely beneficial. Now, of course, with COVID, there has been a lot less of that. There are virtual college visits that can be done, also virtual information sessions. So I highly recommend that students sign up for those. You can even, you know, do those earlier than 11th grade to be able to get a sense. Now, in terms of demonstrated interest, you know, especially with COVID, if this is not going to be an easy thing, stick with a virtual, because the most important thing for demonstrated interest is be sure they have the student's email, the same email that the student will be using to apply, because that's how they're going to track interest. I see a few more questions. Do you
yes, want to see, or if you want to read them, go ahead. I see if colleges are not looking at SAT scores as part of the admission process, what are they looking at?
Yes, so they're looking at all the other criteria, and you know, there are about 10 or 12 different criteria. At the top of that list, it's academic rigor and academic performance. So that's gonna be at the top, but then there are all sorts of other things, including extracurriculars, impact. There are many, many, you know, criteria, and we want to be sure that every single one of those is being optimized to enhance chances of admission and enhance scholarship opportunities. So again, if you want to explore that, then please feel free to go to that link, and that can be a way to find out more. I also see one. Oh, I see one that says, from the admission officer view point of view, what is the difference for student joining the varsity team?
Monday, your group, the centrists, have been promised to vote on the bipartisan infrastructure plan.
Thank you, Christy. From the admission officer point of view, what is the difference for students joining the varsity team in Westlake High School or students joining in athletic clubs outside of the school? Well, that's a good question. You know, colleges are looking for rigor, also depth of commitment in an extracurricular. Being part of, a high school varsity team shows that commitment and that depth of engagement. But that can be accomplished also outside of school. There are many reasons why a student might choose an outside activity rather than one in the school. There are, you know, it really depends on the student. It's not that I don't want to answer your question, is that, like, if I, to really tell you which one I would recommend, I would need to talk to this your child and just see kind of what are the reasons, you know, because I think it's as long as that engagement is really prioritized, I don't think there's a right or wrong here.
Anjali, I think there was one more about a gap year. Does one apply and then request for gap year once admitted, or do you wait?
Yes. So the gap year, there are two ways to do it. One of them is to decide before the fall of senior year that you want to take a, that the student wants to take a gap year. And to put off the application process until the following fall. That allows students to have, you know, a more relaxed senior year and focus on their academics and their extracurriculars. The second option is for students deciding they want to take a gap year, but they are going to do it through deferral. So they ask, they make sure that the college list includes schools that do historically accept the request for deferral for a year. They apply, and then when they are admitted, they choose the school that they want, but then they ask for the deferral. That's usually in the spring of senior year. And then the college will decide, yes, we will hold your space for a year so you can go and do it. Usually what that means is you have to explain. You have to explain why you're asking for that deferral. So the gap year has to be organized. I do work with a lot of kids on gap years. So I know that, you know, whether they're doing it through deferral or whether they are doing it right away, they're going to have to explain through an essay why they've chosen that.
Great. Well, so far, those are the last questions. So I cannot thank you enough, Anjali, for your time. And thank you to West Bank Libraries for hosting. If anyone knows others that were not able to get on today due to timing, we will. We did record this and we will be posting it onto the Healthy Chaps website probably next week, early next week. So just be on the lookout for that. We are linked to the Westlake High School's page, and the principal's weekly newsletter always has a link to the Healthy Chaps newsletter as well.
Thank you so much, Brooke, for moderating and supporting this, this message for parents of aligning, helping students align with their purpose to not only ACE College admissions, but also to cultivate well-being.
You know what, I want to apologize. It capped the room at 100 people, and we had over 100, and I didn't know how to change it to let more people in, but more people came in as some people had left. So just a really good attendance, and I'll figure out how to expand that for the next one.
Yes, that's great. I saw that too and heard that people were trying. So I reminded them in the front office to tell them that we will record it and it will be posted. So
great.
Very thankful for this turnout. Thank you again, Anjali, and I hope everyone has a wonderful rest of their day.
Thank you. Hope to see you all soon. And thanks, West Bank, also. Really, really appreciate it.
You're welcome. And I saved the chat if you want me to send it to you, Anjali, or to
Paul. Yeah, great. That would be great. Thank you so much.
Okay.
Okay. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.